Would you please stand and sing together as we prepare to worship God of Grace and God of Glory? It's hymn number 577. Please be seated. Let me start by saying I welcome you to this time of worship here at the historic Sardis Methodist Church. For those that are joining us via the internet, we welcome you as well. Our prayer is that as we worship together, that we might feel the presence of God's Spirit, and that as we worship in spirit and in truth, that the praises go up and the blessings come down. I do have a couple of announcements to make. We do have church council meeting today immediately following our worship service, and since this is an open Methodist congregation, anybody who wants to attend is welcome to attend. The other thing is that Mary and I would ask your travel mercies. We'll be leaving this week to go on vacation. We're going to sail around Cape Horn, so we'll be gone for a few weeks. And I encourage you to come out and support the guest pastors and those who will be leading worship as we're away. Are there any other announcements that anybody can think that I need to make at this time? Then let us pray. Lord God, we've come into your house, and as we come into your house, we come hoping that we can meet you here. Therefore, our prayer is that you would pour out your Holy Spirit, that we might know your presence, that we might feel the Holy Spirit, that it might move us to amens and hallelujahs. Lord, be with us. We lift these things up. We ask these blessings, and we do it in Christ's name. And God's children all said, amen. The ushers would please come and lift the offering at this time.
Material blessings. And we give it that someone might be influenced to come into a personal relationship with Christ. This is our only motivation. And we do it not out of a sense of obligation, but rather out of a sense of love for all of you God. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
If you'd please remain standing as we join together. Our Psalter is Psalm 90. It's found on page 809 in the hymn book. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O mortal ones.
For a thousand years your sight, or that is yesterday when it is past, or as a watch in the night.
You sweep them away and they are like a dream, like the grass which is renewed in the morning.
In the morning it flourishes and is renewed, in the evening it fades and withers.
For we are consumed by your anger, by your wrath we are overwhelmed.
You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your account.
For all our days pass away under your wrath. Our years come to an end like a sigh.
The years of our life are threescore and ten, or even by reason of strength fourscore. Yet their span is but toil and trouble.
Who considers the power of your anger, the awesomeness of your wrath?
So teach us to number our days, that we may receive a heart of wisdom.
Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants.
Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days.
Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, and as many years as we have seen evil.
Let your work be manifest to your servants, and your glorious power to your children.
Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands. Please be seated. I am going to ask the children to come, and Chad, I may need some help again. One more. I bought this box with me today, and it's got a picture of God in it. So what do you think it looks like? Not real good? Okay. So if you're going to draw a picture of God, how would you draw it? Got any thoughts? What kind of hair would God have? Maybe brown hair? What color eyes? Blue eyes? What else? Anything? I'm going to open this and let you see the picture here in a minute. Okay? What do you think? No? Just one at a time. And I don't want you to say anything until we're done. So you want to come first, Mary Ellen? Okay. So let me see if I can get this open. And we'll see. No, you can't do that, because I want you all to do this one at a time. And I don't want you to say anything until we're done, okay? So I want you to come this side and take a look and see if you can see what God looked like. Now you want to come? You want to come, Jackson? You want to do that, Mariella? Take it and letting some people see. And while you're doing that, I'm gonna share something else. Ah. Hmm. So let's see. While she's doing that, I'm going to ask you to read this, because that's what it says. Who'd you see, first of all? Saw yourself. So read what it says. So see, we all look like God because God created us in his image. And I want to read this. Jackson, can you come and read these passages of scripture here?
God is light, and in him there's no darkness at all. He just said,
so let's think about this. If God is light and you're created in God's image, then you must have some light in you as well, right? And then Jesus came along and affirmed that. Jesus came along and made sure that we understood that. And he said, you are the light of the world. And in order to help you remember that, I want to give you that. And I want to give you that. And I want to give you, well, there's a blue one in here. And I want to give you that one. And every time you can turn it on, every time you turn it on, I want you to remember that you are the light of the world, and it's the light of God that shines through you. Okay? So let us pray. Lord God, we thank you that we know that we're made in your image. And we thank you that you give us the opportunity to be the light of the world. Lord, let us never forget that we represent you. And Lord, we thank you for these young people and that they have the opportunity to share in the light. And we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Ah, coloring books. I'm going to be preaching about that this morning. Thank you. Hey. Oh. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you this morning. We come with a spirit of gratitude. We come with a spirit of love. And Lord, we know that we love because you first loved us. We know that we love because you sent Jesus to hang that we might be reconciled to you. And Lord, we come today seeking a spirit of unity in our world. Lord, we live in a world that is so divided. We live in a country that is so divided. And let us get to the point that once again, we are one nation under God, that we're not on our own agendas, but rather on your agenda. Agenda of love, agenda of compassion, an agenda of peace. Lord, we ask that you would pour your spirit out on the leaders of our countries, that you would pour your spirit out on the leaders of our cities and our communities, that you would pour your spirit out on those who lead the church. And Lord, that they might know your gospel, that they might know that each and every one of us is loved by you. Lord, we come today and we ask that you would wrap your arms of comfort around those who have lost loved ones, that you would touch those who need healing, Lord, because you truly are the great physician, that you would pour out your wisdom and your knowledge into those who research after such horrific diseases like cancer and Alzheimer's. Lord, we just ask that we might see an end to these things. Lord, we know that in the day that you return, that all of these things will come to pass, but our prayer is that we might see the end of some of these in our lifetimes. Lord, we ask you'd be with those that wrestle with relationship issues. And Lord, we just take a moment of silence as we remember those who have given their lives on foreign battlefields, that we might have the freedom to worship. We take a moment of silence for all of those who have lost their lives in the Ukraine and in Israel, and those who have lost their lives around the world. Particularly, we pray for those Christians in Nigeria who, simply because they wanted to follow you, have had their lives taken. So we just take a moment of silence. And Lord, we pray now the words that you gave us through your Son. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would ask that you would stand now and let us sing together our preparation hymn number 144, This Is My Father's World.
Thank you.
seated. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Psalms, and I'll be reading Psalm 139, the first six verses, and then verses 13 through 18. And I want you to hear what David writes. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand on me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high I cannot attain it. And then verse 13 through 18. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you. The word of God for the people of God. I want to begin with a picture today, a picture of the Holy Council seated in the place that we think about when we read the book of Genesis. You know, the Holy Council, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're gathered together, and it's the last day of creation. Everything like the birds and the bees, the sand and the earth and the stars and the sun have been created, and there's some buzz going on that they need to do something greater than that, something that will be the crowning glory of our creation. As they ruminate on this thought, all three with the same thought, all of a sudden the thought comes, we're going to make something magnificent, and we'll call it man, we will call it woman. The author of Genesis records the ending conversation in these words. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all of the wild animals, over all of the creatures that move along the ground. And then comes the punchline. So God created mankind in his own image, and the image of God created he them, male and female he created them. My brothers and sisters, that magnificent creation that God thought about in his triune state, that magnificent creation is you. The magnificent you, each of you. As you reflect on that thought, it begs the question, what does it mean to be human? What this passage of Scripture is telling you is that you were created in the image of God for the glorious reality of being in a permanent relationship with Him. That was the idea in Eden. You may remember that God walked in the garden, and Adam and Eve were aware of God walking in the garden. I can imagine that on a daily basis they had conversations with God until that point when for some reason sin entered and they no longer wanted to have those conversations. As you reflect on the thought of being created in the image of God, consider this, that we have this tendency to put God in a place where his sense of connection to the world is remote. We emphasize the rule of God, and therefore God's distant from the world. But what the psalmist shares with us clearly, it flies in the face of this tendency. David wants us to know that God is Emmanuel, God with us, not just at Christmas, but at all times, everywhere we go. God knows when you sit down and when you get up. God knows where you're going to go before you go there. God knows what you're going to think before you think it. And I want you to think about this. There's nowhere that you can go that God isn't already there. Every word you're going to speak before you speak it, God knows. Understand the power of this. There are no moments, no dark and distant places in your life where God is absent. There are no traumas in which you do not own God's mercies. Others may not understand the pain, the hurt, the fear, the abandonment, the rejection, the loneliness, all of those emotions, but God does, and God walks with you. You know, David begins to have this understanding, and he can't comprehend it. He's overwhelmed, and he writes these words, "I am amazed at what you know. It's too much for me to understand." Like the psalmist, this leads us to the conclusion that the vastness and the greatness of God are beyond our comprehension. You know, I wrote a few words about this in the newsletter this week. Each and every body has 100,000 miles of blood vessels. Think about that. The distance around the earth is about, 3,000 miles, 6,000 miles? Multiply that. Think about how many times you could do. And each and every day, the blood flows through those. Think about the universe. Consider that scientists tell us that at the speed of light, it would take 500 billion years to journey around the perimeter of the universe. Consider that our sun is 1 million times the size of Earth, and it's one of the smaller stars in our galaxy. And yet this infinite God is infinitely aware, intimately aware of every individual on the planet. Every hair on your head, every hair on my head is numbered. Sometimes he has to count a few of less as I've gotten older. Understand that God created every life, and that includes you. In the passage of scripture that we shared today, David speaks about the magnificent you, about the person who God knit together in your mother's womb. Think about it this way. Each and every one of you is unique. A designer original, created by the creator of the universe. And it doesn't stop there. We find ourselves in the hand of a creator who's always at work. You know, my favorite passage in scripture, the one that I claim, is 2 Corinthians 5:17. If any person is in Christ, they are a new creation. One of my former pastors said to me, "God's not through with you yet," and I'm pleased that God's not through with me yet. There's a lot of work left to be done. You know, it's like the prophet Jeremiah informs that each and every one of you, each and every one of us are like clay in the potter's hand. Hear what he writes, "The pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands, so the potter formed it into yet another pot, shaping it as it seemed best to him." Shaping it as it seemed best to him. God created us to be eternal beings. You know, C.S. Lewis says, "You've never met a mere mortal. Never met a more mortal, but God created us to be, and we are eternal beings, and God wants to make us into all that God intended us to be." God continues to make the magnificent you more magnificent all the time. You know, I read this passage and it talked about knitting, and I'm not a knitter. However, my cousin Lil, was an avid knitter, and I watched her day in and day out knitting sweaters and scarves, hats and gloves, and she paid careful attention to every stitch, every color of yarn in just the right place. And some of those that she knitted had intricate patterns in them. Every project had a personal touch. Not one side fits all like a mass market garment. Perhaps some of you know people who knit or crochet and can appreciate the patience and perseverance that it takes to produce a finished product. Think about that when you think about God knitting you together in your mother's womb. I don't knit, but I've done some counted cross stitch, and my objective was to make the back look as good as the front. I share that with you because it presents a powerful image of the God knitting you together in your mother's womb. You are unique, individually, lovingly crafted. You are the magnificent you crafted by the Creator who knit together the universe. Think about David's words as he comes to that realization. He says, "I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Note that he doesn't say made fearfully. He says fearfully made. Fearfully made doesn't mean that you're afraid. What it means is that you have a sense of awe. You are filled with the reverence for the Creator. You recognize the power and majesty of God. You recognize the wonder of His creation. And just as the children stared into the mirror, I encourage you to stare into a mirror and recognize the wonder of His creation, because it includes you. As I thought about being wonderfully made, the question came to my mind was, when was the last time you thought of yourself as wonderfully made? Or the last time someone called you wonderful, magnificent? We live in a culture that wants to define wonderful and magnificent in a different way. You know, Google is a wonderful thing. I went out and I asked about women's magazines, and what came back was Glamour and Vogue. I Googled it for men, and what came back was Gentleman's Quarterly. And I looked at the pictures on some of those, and that's the picture that society, that culture wants to paint of us. TV and social media take that to a whole different level. But what I saw on the front pages of those magazines represented only what a small, small portion of the humanity could ever look like. Let me say to you this morning, the Creator of the universe is telling you that you are wonderful. You're wonderful because I made you that way. You are magnificent because I made you that way. The Creator of the universe, the Creator who knit you together in your mother's womb, is saying to you that you are wonderfully made. You are my creation, and you are magnificent. So what does all this mean? Your identity is not something that is hidden or unknown. You are God's child, and know that before you were formed in your mother's womb, God knew you. I've often heard parents say that this was an unplanned or accidental birth. Rick Warren from Saddleback, in his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, writes these words: "You're not an accident. Your birth was no mistake or mishap, and your life was no fluke of nature. Your parents may not have planned you, but God did. Each of you is a reflection of the Creator's image. Each of you are, in every sense, a masterpiece, a magnificent you." This morning, I encourage you to celebrate the magnificent you
that each of you are. Embrace the magnificent you that you are. You are God's creation. You are God's masterpiece. Recognize your worth. See yourself not as the world sees you, but rather as God sees you. It's all about acknowledging your uniqueness, not just as a product of your experiences, but as a testament to God's creativity. You are a designer original. Fearfully and wonderfully made. Recognize that you are also more than just a body. You are a spirit as well. The psalmist writes these words. Think about this. Your eyes saw my unformed body. Your eyes saw my unformed body. God saw you before you were. God's knitting is not just about physical creation, but about spiritual formation as well. You all know that C.S. Lewis is one of my favorite authors, and he says it this way: you don't have a soul. You are a soul. You have a body. Did you catch it? You are a soul, and you have a body. Lewis is calling on you to celebrate your spiritual identity. And this morning, I encourage you to recognize your worth. The magnificent you is a unique creation of God. Each of you are fearfully and wonderfully made. The psalmist closes with some words of a prayer. And hear these words. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Let this always be your prayer, a prayer that asks God to invade your private life. Invite God to intrude in your life in a way that leads you to the way of everlasting life. Here's the thought. The one who knows you intimately, whose eyes saw your unformed body, and who knitted you together in your mother's womb, is the one who says, I am always with you. I am Emmanuel, the Father who created you, the Son Jesus who redeemed you, and the Holy Spirit who walks with you every day of your life. And then ask God to help you see yourself as he sees you. To see the magnificent you that he has knit together in your mother's womb. Yeah. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you that you have blessed us. We thank you that you have created each and every one of us individually. We say thank you that the psalmist helps us to realize who we really are. And Lord, as we go forth, may that light that came from your image, that light that you implanted in each of us might shine, and may someone see Christ in us and ask the question, what is that light? That we might share with them that they are created in God's image, that they are God's children, and that Jesus Christ wants to have a relationship with them. We lift these things up and we ask these blessings. We do it in Christ's name. And God's children all said, Amen. Let us stand together and sing our hymn, number 77, How Great Thou Art. And now to him who is able to prevent you from falling, to him who is able to present you spotless before the throne of Almighty God, may his peace, his power, and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you.